So good evening, everyone. So this is Gitali Jain, and I'm a marketing brand evangelist in Iuro. So what is Evolve? So Evolve is becoming a platform to learn and share wisdom that leaders possess so as to cultivate an environment of knowledge and experience sharing. It is an open ecosystem fostered to share events that are milestones in creating impactful leaders. So I will welcome everyone to Evolve 01. So today's guest is Nupur Dave. She is an ex-Googler, an author, and an NRI counselor, and a LinkedIn influencer. So she'll speak about her unconventional journey from being an engineer to an author, and how is it important to keep finding your interests in life. Right? So, yeah, okay, more about her. She's written two books till date, and her latest book is named as Back Home. It speaks about how an NRI coming back home might feel, or how he should cope up with the change. So I welcome Ms. Nupur Dave to join us today and share her journey with us.
Thanks a lot.
Also, I now welcome all of you to today's session. I hope everyone will find something to take out of it. We have Stephen Rafal, the CMO of Iuro, as our host today. And I would like for Stephen sir to take this ahead.
Thanks, Gitali. And welcome, Nupur, from Team Iuro. We also have some guests among us. We have some students from a few colleges that we always look forward to placing students from.
Good.
And we have some COEP alumni as well. So I hope it makes you feel right at home.
Yeah, this is great. Thanks a lot for a very warm welcome, and thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. So, Evolve 01 is a session where we bring in leaders to share, from their experiences. And talking about experiences, we always go back to our roots. So could you please, take us back to your roots so that we get to know you a little more?
Absolutely. Stephen, so you've told me that a lot of people who are joining the call today are from Pune.
Yeah.
And I think that makes for a very closer experience home here, because I grew up in Pune and my life was from home to school and then home to junior college. I went to Wardiers and then from home to COEP. After that, I directly moved to the United States. So the way I put it is like somebody who grew up in Pune in a very sheltered sort of place suddenly went into the big bad world. I want to talk a little bit about my interests. I know that a lot of people in this audience are curious about their careers and what their personal hobbies may be and how to merge them. I have always regretted that I did not take up computer science when I was in engineering. But when I look back at the time that I made the decision, when I think very deeply about it, at that time, that was the best decision I could make, which was I took up mechanical engineering. And for a lot of people may have regrets, why didn't I do this? Why didn't I go to that college? Or why didn't I apply here? Or why didn't I go to that company or whatever? The way I see it is you make the best decision you can make at that point in your life with the information that is available to you.
True.
So it's just best to accept what you have done in the past and then try and see, can I course correct it? And if you can't change it, then look for other opportunities that come your way.
Yeah.
So my grandfather was a mechanical engineer in the army. My father was also a mechanical engineer, and he also went to COEP. And I thought that, I should carry the legacy. So I thought even I will be a mechanical engineer. But jokes apart, I found it interesting because I could see things. Like, you can see a gear moving. And when you look at computer engineering, my sister was studying it at that time. And I remember looking at her book and it said something like linked lists. And I was like, what is this? Like, I don't get it. Like, show it to me. What does it look like? And because I didn't have that visual connection with computer science, I decided to do something else. I think I was also fortunate because I did really well at academics at COEP, and that's also something I want to talk about, that, you know, being book smart versus being different things.
Cool.
So luckily I got into Georgia Tech, and after that I had the opportunity to work in two different companies. And when I was in Atlanta at that time, Georgia Tech is in Atlanta. Yeah. And I got this opportunity to work at Google. I would say that changed my life and my thinking, because not because of Google as such, but because of the opportunities that opened up for me in terms of the type of technology I was exposed to, the opportunities to travel, and the opportunities to host or conduct events. I was the COO of the Indian Google Network in the US. That gave me a platform to do a lot of things.
Okay.
The reason why I'm saying this is you can get those same opportunities in any other company that's open-minded. So it doesn't have to be Google.
True.
So you're not like the number one company in the world, as they call it, to be able to get these opportunities. Any company that's transparent and open-minded will be able to provide that to you.
That resonates with me so much, because, you know, leading marketing at IRO, it is always my number one priority to create these opportunities and for developers to take part in these opportunities. You know, for us, it is such a roadblock saying that, hey guys, it's okay. Communication and language, two different things. You just come out and you speak and you'll connect more and you'll find interest more and you'll find opportunities more. You know, that transition is always a little difficult when you come from a very closed mindset.
Right.
So coming to opportunities, you know, there are multiples out there. How do you navigate through all these opportunities out there and find what really interests you? How did you do it?
Yeah, I want to give two answers to this. So let me give you an example of how I chased an opportunity down. Okay. And I mean, maybe I literally chased it by like taking a lift. I'll tell you about it. It's an interesting story, although it was harrowing for me at that time. Okay. When I applied for universities in the US, I got into both Georgia Tech and Virginia Tech for the industrial engineering program. Georgia Tech is number one for industrial engineering in the United States, and Virginia Tech was far behind. At that time, my father thought I should go to Virginia Tech for a reason that my aunts live close by.
A very good valid reason for an Indian family.
It is very valid reason for my dad. But for me, I could, at that time, I didn't have a voice. I didn't know how to tell him that this is number one and I really want it. So what I did is I deferred my admit to later. Now, when I went to Virginia Tech, there was a very, very strong sort of, you know, stomach clenching feeling that this is not my home. This is not where I need to be. And that feeling, I listened to it and it kept pushing me to find what is wrong. Like, should I just wait and graduate? It's just 2 years. What should I do? So one day during the Thanksgiving holidays, I heard that two Indian students were traveling in their car to Atlanta. And this is literally, I'm walking on the road and someone was talking about it, and I stopped them and I said, I might need to go to Atlanta. Can I have a ride with you? So the way I explain it is I literally asked for a lift on the road. They took me there. I visited the university, and the minute I sat down with some of the students there and they showed me their books, there was this feeling inside me that said, this is for me. And then there was no stopping me. I didn't have the finances, but somehow we got the finances together. I didn't even have a means to go back to Virginia Tech, so I took a Greyhound bus. If anyone knows how that bus is, it smells of drugs, let's just put it that way. And the reason why I wanted to explain this is because one way of finding what you really, really want to do is by listening to that stomach feeling that you have and pursuing it. Now, there's a counter to that. What if you're interested in so many things, you don't know what you're interested in? And I'll give you an example. I am super interested in food photography. And when I came to India, I was so happy because in India, I don't need a job in the sense, from a visa standpoint. In the US, you have to have a visa. You have to have a job to be on a visa. So here I said, okay, I'm going to try writing. I'm going to try photography. I'm going to try, I don't know, this, that. I had like 100 things I wanted to do. And I slowly found that it's not practical to spread yourself too thin and like too many things or be too confused. The only way I got out of that dilemma was by prioritizing. Okay. And the way I prioritized, I thought, what is the impact I can have? So by food photography, can you imagine the impact you'll have by food photography? You put it on Instagram, someone likes it, they'll comment on it, they'll feel happy, and then they'll move on. Are you changing someone's life? Probably not. But through writing, there is a potential of changing someone's life. And that's actually happened. I've had people reach out to me and say, after I read your book, I now suddenly have clarity on where I should be living. And imagine that impact multiplied by even 100 is, I think the purpose of my life gets fulfilled by that. So what I would say is that consciously prioritize what you want to work on and work towards it. Can I just add one more thing? Sure. I don't know if we can poll here, but how many of y'all have taken a Udemy course or a Coursera course and not finished it? Can you raise your hand?
Yeah, definitely.
There are many.
It's courses. It's like courses.
Yes. So the way I see it, dabbling here and there, it's a mistake I did. So the way I say it, learn from my fail. I dabbled a lot here and there. Since a lot of y'all are developers, something that would resonate closer to you is there's a language called R. I don't know if you've heard of it. The letter R, it's a statistical language. I learned that on my own. It took me 3 years to learn it, simply because I didn't know what I was doing. I was just taking one book, reading two chapters, doing half a course somewhere, doing something on a weekend. It didn't really add up to anything and it took so long. What I wish I could have done is actually taken a serious course. And this is not just the, oh, you get a certificate at the end of this. This is something where you put a skin in the game, like maybe you're paying for it or you're physically going to some place and taking a course.
Yeah.
I feel like that is the commitment that will get you to the next level of whatever you want to achieve.
So having your skin in the game, very, very valid point. So coming to a very, very important question and for a lot of people here, did you go after Google or did it come to you? How did it turn out?
Okay, I want to talk about underestimating yourself.
Okay.
Rather not aiming high enough.
Okay.
So as I mentioned, my dad went to COEP, and I remember when I was in the 11th standard, we were driving past COEP, and I remember telling somebody that, oh, COEP, that's for scholars, like I will never go there. And I ended up in COEP. And I feel like the same thing happens with a lot of the goals that we have. I really never thought I would get into Google. I applied to it once through a friend of mine way back in 2005. And at that time, it didn't work out. So I didn't think too much about it. In the year 2007, I was just randomly going through some websites and I thought, let's apply to Google. I'm not going to get in anyway. So I just, in 5 minutes, I just wrote down something on my resume and I just submitted it. I was like, who cares? And then I get an email 2 days later. I honestly thought someone was playing a prank on me. So all in all, even if you think that a referral might increase your chances of getting through somewhere, it's all about aiming high and pursuing what you feel you dream about.
Yeah.
There is a counter to this where some people overestimate. You know, it's like me going and telling people like I can play cricket like Sachin Tendulkar, you know. I can't. But you have to estimate yourself correctly. And how do you do that? I don't know, Stephen, if you've met people who, like in we say in India, right, they think too much of themselves.
Oh, yes.
The thing is that they don't know that they can't do something or they are thinking too much of themselves. And this is where you need people who can give you very critical feedback, and you have to be open to listening to what people are trying to tell you. That's the only way you can become better.
Yeah, so that is so true, you know, out of even sometimes we fall prey to the same thing, where we do not understand feedback or we do not take feedback into consideration. And then we look at things from a perspective that's very biased, right? Okay, but still not hopping on from Google to the next. How was life at Google? Because a lot of people, that is their dream job. So how was it inside?
I'll absolutely tell you. I think someone's posted a question on chat. So I want to tell everyone, continue to post your questions. We'll get to them before the end of this chat. So that, Stephen, I can continue, but please keep typing your questions. Okay, so I would like to say that when I joined Google in 2007, it was a smaller company. I think there were about 25,000 people. I remember walking into a party at, party means just a big dinner in Atlanta. And when I told them I work for Google, all 25 people turned to look at me. And in that moment, I actually got a bit scared because I realized that people are judging me based on a label on me rather than who I am as a person. So I decided from that day onwards, and it's kind of funny, that anyone asks me, where do you work? I tell them the location. Like I'll tell them Senapati Bapat Road. So some people catch on to that, some don't, but I try to avoid telling it because it brings unnecessary attention. I know there are some other people who like to talk about it, but it's just not me. To talk about how Google is different from other companies that I have worked in, I don't know how your company is, but one is the culture of data. So you could literally go to your director or your senior managers if you have certain data, and you can, I'm trying to not use the word argue, but you can argue it out that you are right. And they'll be open to course correct based on your feedback. So what I've noticed is that the influence of ego is kind of less. If you take data to prove something, you can get your way. It also makes it a very bottom-up culture, which means I, as a minion, if I put it that way, have the same amount of influence if I had a good idea as anybody else. It also has a culture of making everyone equal. So a director will have the same perks as any normal person. I'll give you an example. If you're taking a flight from India to the US, based on certain rules that are in the system, you are eligible, you can take a business class flight. So you don't have to be a senior manager to take it. So this way, a lot of people feel very well cared for. I do want to mention that there are a lot of information on the internet that says Google has free haircuts, free oil change on campus. And I'm talking this from a US perspective. But I do want to mention a couple of things. Not all of these services are free. And the second thing is, after some time, you get used to it. And the novelty doesn't remain, you know. So if we would say there's free food, after 2 months, you'll start complaining about that free food. Another thing, there are a lot of companies now that are following this model. So companies like Facebook, Twitter, Dropbox. In fact, smaller companies have even better chefs or more personalized food that's produced on campus. So again, that's not a novelty. But yeah, in general, Google has kept the bar pretty high though I don't know how it's changed in the past few years, because they're expanding a lot, but they were very picky. And that makes, it's not a good experience for you as a person, but for the company it's good, and I'll explain what I mean. For example, they will take somebody from IIM Ahmedabad to do account, ads account related keyword work. So for someone with an MBA, maybe they may not want to work on something small like that, but because it's Google, they would take up that job. So for Google, they're getting a very high caliber person for something.
As basically.
So, good.
I've seen a different side of this, just an insight, you know, because of this conversation. I have a very dear friend called Clinton. He's from Metro. And in Metro, they have this thing where they take a person and they put him through all the departments, you know, for some time, so that he has an overall idea as to how the company functions. And then when they get back to their roles, they expect or forecast as to how the other department would work and, you know, as a team. So very, very different experiences here, and very interesting.
Yeah.
But yeah, Nupur, two books, okay, that's no small feat. You know, being in the content process, writing a few pages also takes a mammoth of a, you know, effort and time, and also wading through a lot of blockages. How does it come to you, and, you know, what's the process?
The process for writing a book is fairly simple. Anyone can write it. And in 1 minute, I'll tell you what people charge, like, I don't know, 10,000 rupees to tell you over 2 days.
Okay.
So everyone's heard of an FAQ, right?
Yeah.
So suppose you have a topic. Stephen, tell me, what is your favorite topic that maybe you'd want to write a book on?
Hot Wheels.
Hot Wheels.
Yeah, Hot Wheels.
What is that?
That's, you know, these miniature cars which are very realistic in nature.
Oh, very nice. So there you go. That was the first question of your FAQ. What is Hot Wheels?
Got it. So
what you can do is think about maybe the top 10 to 20 most likely questions that someone may ask for Hot Wheels. And then just write under each one of those questions and just keep expanding it.
Mm.
That becomes your book.
Very nicely put.
Yeah.
So, you know, as task oriented as we usually tend to be, I expect books from everyone who's in the session.
So I'll tell you one thing. There are content writers I've worked with, and content writers do writing as a full-time job, and each of them wants to write a book. So now you would think, this is a full-time job. What is preventing you from writing? Like, I have a full-time job, which is in technical product management. So I've taken time out from that to write my books.
True.
So what is the difference between them? Like, what are they not doing that they could do? And this is where what we could say is the slogging comes in. It's so boring. It's so boring to write. I remember I have been like writing before office, writing after office, staying up at night and suddenly waking up at midnight and writing. So I have sacrificed my weekends for this. So it is, I don't want to call it hard work, because hard work is a very boring word, I feel. It's very overrated, or I don't believe in quote unquote hard work. But here's the trick you could do. Pay someone, like maybe just as a joke, somebody can pay Stephen to keep them accountable, that if I don't write a book, then Stephen gets 40,000 rupees or something like that. Or maybe I split it. If I write,
I want all the other leadership listening to this. It's so much fun.
So you become their accounting, you get an accountability coach. And again, I spoke earlier about putting a skin in the game. And usually, you know, even telling somebody publicly, like you put it on your Facebook that I'm going to do this, that can work for some people.
True.
But for some people, unless it's related, it has money in at stake, they won't do it. True. This is definitely an extreme thing, but it really helps to have a deadline and have someone to commit to.
In terms of your book at home, that's very personal, right? That comes out of your experiences. Yes. We will be sharing the link of the book with everyone. But you know, when you write personal experiences, how do you decide, as to the flow of it, what I'm talking about, will it resonate with other people? These are questions that you usually want to say, even in conversations. So I'm not coming from a book angle. In conversations, I want to make sure that what I feel and what I'm talking about, would it resonate with the other person? The book is just an amplified version of that thought. So did it come to you that, how do I be selective of what I write or my thought processes?
Yeah, once you write something personal, it's out there permanently in stone.
Yeah.
So it's very tricky. Now it depends on your age, your comfort level. What I found is that in general, we as a society are a little bit judgmental.
True.
So if you find people writing certain things on, say, Facebook, I mean, I still do that. I'm like, maybe I'll be like, what is this person? Has nothing better to do. Why are they wasting their time on something like this? And it becomes tricky as to, how much should you be revealing?
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. If you look deeply inside you and ask yourself, why are you revealing this information? If that answer comes back, you know what? I actually am doing this because I want attention. You know, I'm not saying about me, but I'm just saying, I have a cousin who posts selfies every day. So what's your goal for posting selfies? The only answer I can come up with is getting attention to yourself, which becomes very unhealthy. Like your mental health suffers, because if you don't get that, then you start feeling restless. You need that feed every day. But if your answer is that I genuinely want this information to help other people, make a difference in their lives, or whatever reason. Maybe it is, I genuinely think this information will help the company move forward or my project move forward. Then it may be worth sharing, whatever it is, even if it's something really personal.
Perfect. So it boils down to minuscule aspects, as if the task I'm doing, if I feel overburdened by it, should I project it further and tell that, hey, I'm feeling a little stressed over here and because of this, and that might clear things out for you. It's as simple as, understanding why you're doing and why you're communicating a certain thing.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you put it out there that, exactly in the words that you said it, people are more receptive to what information you're putting out there. Yeah. So being honest. Having said that, it's never too good to be too honest, which I've been in the past.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you, it just gets better with age.
That's it. You tend to, care a little less about perceptions then.
Absolutely. You care less. And at the end of the day, what is going to take you forward in your life and your career? Focus on yourself. I have spent a lot of time in my past thinking about other people, or maybe even gossiping about them, and thinking that, why is it that this person got it and I didn't get it? I deserve this more than them. And I realize it doesn't make any difference at the end of the day. You'll just keep whining and you'll never move yourself forward. So the best is to just focus on what am I doing to make a difference and make progress in my life.
Perfect. On that note, Nupur, as I've already thanked you, and it's been an absolute pleasure and learning, for all of us. And hopefully even you had a good time interacting with our guys.
I did. I really enjoyed this. Thanks so much for having me.